Good afternoon, everyone. I am JP, and today we are going to learn environmental science, more specifically pollution, and also into that water pollution. So first, let's analyze what is environmental pollution. Environmental pollution is that aspect which involves any addition of a substance, whether it is solid, liquid, or gaseous, or any form of energy, maybe thermal energy, which creates a disturbance in the carrying capacity of the environment. That means the rate of addition of these substances is so much that the environment cannot carry it that much, and it creates disturbance. This creates environmental pollution. In that environmental pollution, there are different types. Most of the types are air pollution, water pollution, noise pollution, radiation pollution, soil pollution, solid waste pollution, etc., etc. For this class, we are especially going to study water pollution. Also, in water pollution, we will be understanding what are its indicators. That means, how do we understand whether water pollution has taken place? Then the sources of water pollution, the effects, and the control measures. So let's start with the indicators of water pollution. First of all, how do we understand whether the water is polluted? Through preliminary understanding, through physical watching the water as such, we can say that the water is polluted if it is black, if it is stinking, if there is no aquatic life, if we see dead fishes lying around, etc., etc. But these are physical evidences, and we need something technical and scientific to corroborate that. How do we do that? For that, we have certain technical indicators. One of the technical indicators is DO. DO stands for dissolved oxygen. Dissolved oxygen is measured in milligrams per liter. Water bodies, they have dissolved oxygen at different levels. Accordingly, the trophicity of the water is calculated, trophic index. If the dissolved oxygen is high, the water is oligotrophic, and as it reduces, it becomes eutrophic. But that is not important. The important is dissolved oxygen and the amount of dissolved oxygen present in the water. According to WHO standards, if the dissolved oxygen is less than 8 milligrams per liter, the water becomes contaminated. It is assumed to be contaminated. And if it drops below 4 mg per liter, it is highly polluted. So this is one of the standards. The second indicator is BOD. BOD stands for biochemical oxygen demand. Now, biochemical oxygen demand is that indicator. It says that how much quantity of oxygen is required for a bacteria to decompose organic matter. That means if the biochemical oxygen demand is high, that means the bacteria needs a lot of oxygen to decompose the organic matter present in water. This indicates that the dissolved oxygen is less, that means the water is polluted. So high BOD, that means the water is polluted. Similarly, there is one more indicator, and that is CO. CO is chemical oxygen demand, and it is more reliable than BOD, because chemical oxygen demand, it undertakes, it takes into consideration the amount of oxygen required to oxidize all the organic matter, whether biodegradable or non-biodegradable. So this is a much reliable indicator and mostly used to analyze how much water is contaminated. Now let's turn to the sources of water pollution. The classification of sources can be done into two major types. The first one is point sources, and the second one is non-point sources. In point sources, we come to know from where the pollutant is coming. From non-point sources, we are not sure from where exactly the pollution is happening. For example, in point sources, If you know that in a water body, say in a river, we find certain chemicals. That chemical can be traced to a certain industry, certain factory located alongside the river. This makes us sure that this chemical must have come from that industry. So that becomes a point source of solution. Non-point source of solution means we really don't know from where the pollutant is coming. It could have come from an agriculture site, from slaughter, or from household waste, from anything. So that is non-point source. Now let's get into effects. There are many mal effects of water pollution. Apart from the usual disease causing effects, disease causing pathogens in the water, they cause diseases like jaundice, typhoid, cholera, etc. But apart from that, there are certain different kind of diseases. For example, something known as blue baby syndrome. This happens when water contains excessive nitrate. Excessive nitrate is important for plant growth, yes. And that's why due propagation also results due to excessive nitrate. But if this water is consumed by human beings, we get something known as blue baby syndrome. Now why it is known as blue baby syndrome? Because nitrate, when it is taken ingested by infants, it has the tendency to replace hemoglobin. So once hemoglobin is replaced by nitrate, entire body turns blue because this nitrate is blue. That's why the body turns blue, and that's why it's known as blue baby syndrome. And it is very harmful for infants. Then there are certain other elements which are which you find in the water. One of those elements is cadmium. Cadmium is highly carcinogenic. Once cadmium gets ingested into the body, it starts with a disease known as itai in Japanese. Cadmium gets locked into joints and it creates movement of joints very difficult. And itai is the pain actually, which Japanese call in their language, which is caused due to cadmium poisoning. Next is arsenic. Arsenic water contamination causes diseases like something known as keratogenesis, where the skin becomes scaly. And in this disease, it's very difficult for, people feel a lot of itchiness because of arsenic. Also, arsenic is carcinogenic. It is one of the most important agents of forming cancer. There is something known as black foot disease, which we also get because of arsenic. Now, arsenic contamination in contemporary times is found in Bengal basin. In the Gangetic region of Bengal and Bihar, we get arsenic contamination, and this contamination mostly due to groundwater seepage, river water seepage to ground. And then groundwater usage is a lot in that area, and people drinking water get affected by arsenic contamination. Apart from all these things, there are many other problems and effects of water contamination. But what control measures is the government or the local bodies, what control measures are they taking in order to reduce these effects? On the national scale, there are many control measures. First and most important one is Swachh Bharat. Swachh Bharat, then Namami Gange program. And all these programs, the basic aim is to control water pollution, to stop spread of sewage water into the drinking water sources. Apart from that, there are many secondary sources, secondary methods. A like treatment of sewage at home in the society itself. If you have sewage treatment plant in the society, then the government gives you certain subsidies. These are certain schemes. Then organic farming is one such thing. In organic farming, there is very less use of fertilizers. Natural fertilizers are utilized, but also ones are very rarely used. So this also reduces the input of chemicals into the water. Apart from that, there are certain vegetative measures, you can call it. For example, water hyacinth, if it is grown in a plant body, it has the ability to take heavy metals inside. And this also acts as a purifying agent in the water. And lastly, legislation, which is utilized to control water. The most important one is Prevention of Water Pollution Act. Of Water Pollution Act 1972. This act encompasses all the necessary laws, rules and regulations with respect to industries and with respect to agriculture, how much effluent should be introduced in the water bodies and what punishment should be given if an industry or any other source is found guilty of creating pollution in the water body.